Hello everyone, and welcome back to our Introduction to Causal Inference course. And today's video is going to be about the second part of our lecture on the potential outcomes model. In the first part of the lecture, we discussed what potential outcomes are and used them to define the fundamental problem of causal inference. And in today's video, we want to again use the concept of potential outcomes, this time to define what we call average or aggregated causal effects. The first thing I wanted to talk about is the idea that individual level causal effects can vary. That is, the causal effect does not need to be the same across all individuals in our population. In the example we discussed in the last video, in Fernando's case, taking aspirin caused the headache to go away. And we can wonder, is it the case that taking aspirin will cause the headache to go away in all individuals in a given population? Well, not necessarily the case. A simple example would be Fernando takes the aspirin, but his headache does not go away. And in fact, when you have a binary exposure and a binary outcome, we can define four types of effects that are summarized here in this table. So in the first row is a situation where no matter what the exposure, the individual does not have the outcome. So we say that this is a immune individual. Immune in the sense that he or she doesn't have the outcome regardless of the status of the exposure. The second type of causal effect in the second row here is when taking the exposure causes the outcome to occur. So this means that the potential outcome under no exposure is outcome failure, and when we have the exposure, potential outcome corresponds to outcome success. The opposite effect would be when the outcome is present only under non-exposure. In this case, we would say that the exposure prevents the outcome from happening. And the fourth and final type of effect is the situation where the individual is always affected. That is, regardless of the exposure, the individual always has the outcome. So notice that both the fourth and the first rows in this table illustrate no causal effect, right? Because there is no difference between the two potential outcomes. However, those are two different types of individuals because they differ regarding outcome occurrence. But why there may be heterogeneity in the individual level causal effect? How is this even possible? Well, that's actually not very surprising. In epidemiology, we often discuss this concept of effect modification or interaction. And essentially, this boils down to the idea that in some individuals, some effect modifiers will be present, and in other individuals, other effect modifiers will be present. And therefore, the individual level causal effects can differ between individuals, both between individuals in the same population, if we're talking about individual level effect modifiers, or between two populations, if we're talking about population level or contextual effect modifiers, or just individual level effect modifiers that happen to have different prevalences between populations. So to illustrate the idea of average or aggregated causal effects, let's consider a very simple example where we have a population with four individuals. So here I'm using n to denote the population size. And I am indexing each one of these individuals by the letter I. So for example, I equals 3 means that we're talking about the third individual in this population. For example, we can see here in the third row of the table that X equals 1. This means that the third individual is exposed, and we can represent that by X sub 3 equals 1. And notice that this table also shows individual level causal effect. So for example, the causal effect in individual 1 was negative 1. So we can represent this by I sub 1 equals negative 1. And in our example, we can clearly see here that the individual level causal effects are heterogeneous because we see different values here in this last column. So now we can define what the average causal effect is. The average causal effect is very simple. It's just the arithmetic mean of the individual level causal effects in the population, which is essentially what this notation here means, where the operator E denotes the expectation of the individual level causal effects. The advantage of working with this operator is that it applies to superpopulations or populations of infinite size, which are often the object of interest, at least conceptually, when we do statistical analysis. Forgetting about those rather subtle details, we can understand the average causal effect as the average of the individual level causal effects in our population. So here in our example, we simply add up all individual level causal effects in the numerator and divide them by the population size. That's essentially what the average is. And in our example here, the average causal effect is 1/4 or 0.25. So to gain some more intuition on the meaning of the average causal effect and also on the difference between causation and association, let's consider this figure here, where we have a population of interest represented by this figure, and in white we have the subset of treated or exposed, and in gray we have the subset of untreated or unexposed. When you're talking about causation, more specifically when you're talking about the average causal effect, we're talking about the following comparison: the difference between two averages. One of them is the average value of the outcome in the situation where everyone in our population is exposed, which is indicated here by the symbol completely filled in white. And the other value is the average value of the outcome in the situation where everyone in our population is not exposed. And this is represented by the symbol here, filled in entirely in gray. If we knew both of these averages, we would simply subtract one from the other, and this would give us the average causal effect. If we were interested solely in association, we would simply compare the average value of the outcome among those who were exposed with the average value of the outcome among those that were not exposed. Notice here that this comparison does not involve the entire population in both quantities, whereas when we want to calculate the average causal effect, we need the entire population being exposed and also unexposed, so we can compare the two and then obtain the average causal effect. And this definition of the average causal effect is actually equivalent to our previous definition based on the average value of the individual level causal effects. That is because the individual level causal effect is simply the difference between the two potential outcomes, and given the properties of the expectation operator, when we have a subtraction inside the expectation operator, we can split that up into the difference between expectations. Again, going back to our example with four individuals in our population, we saw that the average causal effect was 0.25, but we noticed that the individual level causal effect varied. That is, we noticed that in our population there was heterogeneity in the causal effect. And in this situation, we could say that the average causal effect captures the sort of overall behavior of the population regarding the causal effect. There is actually a distribution of individual level causal effects that this single measure of average causal effect simply does not capture. And in practice, when we suspect that there might be causal effect heterogeneity, it may be useful to consider average causal effects not only overall, but also within certain subgroups of the population. For example, we could calculate the average causal effect within strata of suspected effect modifiers. For example, if we think that sex might modify the causal effect, we could calculate the average causal effect within males and the average causal effect within females. Ideally, we are going to define these strata or subgroups based on some theoretical justification, but in principle, it's also possible to do this in a more exploratory way. And when we do that, that is, when we calculate subgroup-specific average causal effects, those have a name, and the name is conditional average causal effects. It is important to understand, guys, that conditional average causal effects are still average effects, because we're still averaging individual level causal effects. Only this time we're doing this within subgroups rather than for the entire population. So we can understand the conditional average causal effects as the arithmetic mean of the individual level causal effects, but not for the entire population, but only for a certain subgroup of the population. Let's try to understand this a little bit more concretely with this example. Suppose we want to assess if the effect of x on y differs according to the binary covariable c. So we have this covariable c, which is binary, and we hypothesize that it might modify the effect of x on y. So in this case, we will define the conditional average causal effect in the group c equals 0 as the average of the individual level causal effects in all individuals that belong to this group. And the same for the conditional average causal effect in the group c equals 1. So to make things more concrete, let's imagine that c represents the variable sex, such that c equals 0 indicates that the individual is male and c equals 1 indicates that the individual is female. So we could calculate two types of conditional average causal effects: the average causal effect in males and the average causal effect in females. The average causal effect in males is just the arithmetic mean of the individual level causal effects in the first and third individuals, because they are the two male individuals in our hypothetical populations. And in this example, this conditional average causal effect equals negative 0.5. And we can do the same thing for females, except that we're going to be averaging over individuals 2 and 4. And if you do that, we get the value of 1. And here's a notation that we can use to refer to a conditional average causal effect. It's again the expectation of the individual level causal effects, or simply the average of individual level causal effects, but not for the entire population, but restricted to a given subgroup of this population. And this is exactly what this bar c equals 0 is denoting. So this means that we are taking the expectation, or taking the average, only for a specific subgroup, in this example for the subgroup where c equals 0, rather than for the entire population. The same thing for females, except that we change the value from 0 to 1. And perhaps a natural question for us to ask is, why should we care about conditional average causal effect? Couldn't we simply calculate, say, the average causal effect in the entire population and go with that? As it turns out, calculating conditional average causal effects can be of interest in different situations. A very basic situation where conditional average causal effects arise is when we stratify our analysis according to one or more variables. We are going to see that stratification is the basic strategy for confounding adjustment. And confounding adjustment is key when we try to estimate causal effects. So we are going to be sometimes implicitly dealing with conditional average causal effects many times throughout this course. From a more practical perspective, conditional average causal effects are useful because they allow identifying subgroups where the exposure has larger effects. This can have a wide range of practical applications. For example, suppose we have a given public health intervention. If we know subgroups of the population that benefit more from this intervention, we could tailor the delivery of this intervention so as to optimally target those subgroups and then improve the effect of the intervention. And a related application is in the optimization of the risk-reward ratio of medical treatments. So let's say that we have a specific medical treatment that has well-known side effects. So we want to apply this treatment only to patients with a high probability of having a substantial benefit from this treatment. Otherwise, the treatment could be more harmful than beneficial to the patient. And more abstractly, conditional average causal effects allows us to answer questions of the form, who benefits, who is harmed, and who is unaffected by the given intervention or treatment. And from a more basic science perspective, conditional average causal effects can also be helpful for us to better understand disease etiology. And this is simply because the more you understand about how the outcome comes about, the better we understand how the disease works. So here are just some motivations for caring about conditional average causal effects. That being said, guys, in most of the course, we're going to be focusing on the average causal effect as our causal parameter of interest. So that's it for this video, guys. I hope it was clear and useful for you. And I see you again for part 3 of this lecture.